study for of course, this is Russian, from Russian school. So whoever you want, take it for everything. You think it how big it will be taken, kind of bring later, more and more and more. Here was late in the National Cinema, but only some articles were very, very important. Not now,
there is a break. Okay, so it's a pleasure to start this afternoon session at this great occasion. And the first speaker is Dina Sharir from Tel Aviv University.
We invited to give a talk in this symposium to celebrate Vitaly's 80th birthday. I have too many slides, I will run out of time, and I have some more slides that talk a little bit about Vitaly and me. And I'm going to tell you about an anecdote that is some kind of a dark spot on my resume. I take all the blame on myself, but it is related to Vitaly, and I think it's about time, almost 50 years later, to tell it. So why am I here? Because after finishing the PhD, which I did with Aldo Lazar in functional analysis, I was looking for a postdoc. I still stayed at Tel Aviv University. I was kind of feeling lost, kind of disliking or not understanding the area. But Vitaly was there. He took me under his wing, so to speak. And for about 2 years, we worked together and had two papers. Here are the papers. And I want to talk about the second paper, which actually has changed my life. I cannot tell you what the paper was about. I have no recollection whatsoever. But what I remember is that the original result was stronger than what the paper actually presents. And the problem is that we didn't check it very thoroughly. And before we finished everything, Vitaly arranged for me to give a talk about it at the seminar at the Hebrew University. And the late Yoram Lindenstrauss was in the audience, fidgeting in his chair for a few minutes, and then asked me, is this what you are going to prove? I said yes, and said, well, it's wrong. Here is a counterexample. And for a young PhD, just out of his thesis work, this was really the trauma of my life. We finally fixed the paper, fixed the mistake, downgraded it, gave it this very strange title, and went on. And what happened as a consequence, it really made a big difference because it taught me somehow, at least scientifically, not to trust anybody, not to trust myself, to be suspicious of everything, to check everything before accepting it and so on. And it actually worked. I think that in retrospect, it was a very good experience for me, thanks to Vitaly. And maybe everyone should have such a thing, because it really gives you a totally different perspective of what and how to do. At any rate, So I really was not very close to Vitaly. I know about him, but other people know much more. But still, he was around, or still around. And I learned to admire his work in, in geometry-related thing. And also, I don't know if no less important or, but equally important is his monumental effort to absorb the mathematicians from the former Soviet Union, which he was really the main figure, if I'm not mistaken, in all these things and did marvelous things. The other item I want to mention is that if you ever talked with Vitaly, not in Russian, you had to use a special language, which I called Vitalese, and everyone who spoke with him knows what it is. It was really fun. It made me speak both English and Hebrew quite inconsistently, so to speak, to match the style of Vitaly, but it was fun, and we understood each other quite well. But I think the third point is really that his unbounded energy and enthusiasm and kind of doing everything at once, and but also just being a so-called mensch. I mean, it was really very helpful to be in the vicinity of such a person. And there are many more things about him that other people could say, and I assume they would. And yet, another anecdote before I go into the stuff I want to talk about. I don't remember exactly when it was. It was probably 10 years ago that he had a car accident.
Longer?
I don't really remember. I remember visiting him in the hospital, and he told me that when the accident happened, the thought that crossed his mind is something like, okay, I've already done enough, which really impressed me a lot, still does. But I think that he was underestimating himself, and and certainly there is a lot more that he can and will and has done. So that's more or less what I want to tell you about Vitaly, and I really want to wish him a very happy birthday and thank him for just being there. For me, it was a great thing, still is. Okay, now, after the Vitaly years, I switched to computer science. I first did my postdoc on optimizing compilers for high-level programming languages, which is as far from functional analysis as you could probably imagine. Maybe not as far as possible, but fairly far. And then I switched to robotics, and then to computational and combinatorial geometry. And this is brings us to the topic I want to talk about. Okay, end of introduction. So I want to talk about algebraic methods, recent developments in algebraic methods, computational geometry. It's a survey. A few of you may have heard versions of it before. Most of you probably didn't. Anyway, no need to introduce Paul Erdős, who was among the key players in this area, one of the founding fathers, if not the founding father. And the two problems that he wrote about, that he introduced in a short paper in the American Mathematical Monthly, 1946. He himself regarded them as his most striking contributions to geometry. And there are two such, the two problems are distinct distances and repeated distances. In the distinct distance problem, you are given a set of endpoints in the plane, and you want a lower bound, d of n, on the number of distinct distances determined by the pairs of points. Of course, if the set is in general position, you will get n choose two distinct distances, but if you make the set S degenerate as possible, you still want to claim that you will have at least that many distinct distances. And the opposite problem, so to speak, is that I give you a distance, say one, and I ask you how many pairs in a set of n points in the plane can be at distance exactly one for us. What is the maximum possible number of such pairs? I'm going to focus on the distinct distance problem, but the repeated distance somehow appears to be much harder and is still kind of stuck. Okay, so Erdős observed that if you look at the points on the integer lattice, square root n by square root integer lattice, you get n over square log n, only n over square log n distinct distances. And he conjectured that this is also a lower bound, that you can never get fewer. We always have at least that many distinct distances. And the problem really was stuck for a long time. And with traditional methods, people could get something like n to the 0.86, but still far from the n over square root log n conjecture bound. Now, the person to whom whose name will appear quite a few times in the talk, and who was in a sense responsible for this revolution indirectly, is Gyuri Eletes. He died only a few months before everything started, but his ideas were the fuel that started it all. He was thinking about the distinct distance problem and found a very ingenious transformation, I'll say a few words about it later, that reduces this problem to incidences between points and lines in three dimensions. You'll see how in a minute. But the reduction was one step. The second step was to prove a certain bound on the number of such incidences. Again, I'll formulate it soon. But he had no idea how to prove the conjecture. If he could prove the conjecture, he could get n over log n lower bound, almost the upper bound of n over square root log n of Erdős. So essentially, the problem would have been solved. But he couldn't solve it, nobody else could. And he died at a fairly young age out as a consequence of heavy smoking. So maybe if you can refrain from smoking, that might be the most important message of this talk. Anyway, so just a few months after he passed away, the two main characters that actually proved something, not just conjectures, were Larry Good and Nets, Hawk, Katz, who wrote two groundbreaking papers in 2008 and 2010. And the first one was about a smaller problem, smaller in importance, but still quite hard and still a problem. I mean less important in the
why,
sense of, I don't know, because Erdős didn't ask it, perhaps. Okay, an equally important problem. Okay, a problem concerning joints. What are joints? Okay. So the problem is the following. You have a set L of n lines in three dimensions, and you call a point a joint if it is incident, if it lies on at least three of your lines, and not all the lines that pass through it are coplanar. Like in this construction, which is composed of an integer, three-dimensional integer grid, every vertex of the grid, if you draw lines through them in the three coordinate directions, every vertex is a joint because the three lines that pass through it are clearly non-coplanar. And if you want n to be the number of lines, then you work out the calculation here, the number of vertices of the grid is proportional to n to the 3/2. So in this construction, you can have about n to the 3/2 joints if you have n lines. And the question was whether this bound is tight, namely whether no matter how the lines are, you always get at most n to the order of n to the 3/2 lines. Joints. And this is what Gut and Katz did in their first paper. They proved it using algebraic techniques. The tools that they used were fairly simple. I will not go into the details of the proof. It followed ideas by Dvir for finite fields. And they proved this upper bound. You can skip the bottom part of the slide, which talks about that it can be generalized to higher dimensions. The proof eventually got simplified, that with an extra slide or two, I could show you the entire idea, but I will not. So the history was that after the joint result, I tried to apply to the distinct distance problem. Elekesh passed away, and I had his notes from the past. I published it with his name, too, and that triggered Gut and Katz to grab these ideas and solve the missing part, the things that Elekesh conjectured, and eventually they obtained this n over log n lower bound, a number of distinct distances. Let me give you some ideas about, it's quite old by now, but still I think it's kind of interesting to see the details. So Elekesh's idea was to consider the space of all rigid motions, which he called rotations of the plane, as points in three dimensions, because you have 3 degrees of freedom for a rigid motion, two of translation and one of rotation. And the observation is that if you have two pairs of points, A, B, and A prime, B prime, there is a rotation that takes A to A prime and B to B prime, if and only if they are at the same distance. So what he did was pairing A with A prime and defining the locus H A prime of all rotations that take A to A prime. And similarly, the locus H B B prime, all rotations take B to B prime. Now, if you take A to A prime, you are left with just 1 degree of freedom. So you get a one-dimensional object. And with the proper parametrization, it is actually a line. So you get a system of n square lines, about n square lines. And if the distance from AB is equal to the distance from A prime to B prime, then the line AA prime and the line BB prime will meet in three dimensions at the point which is the common rotation that takes A to A prime. And the actual proof is just Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. So if you call x the number of distinct distances and enumerate them as delta 1 through delta x, and you take all the pairs that are a distance delta I, call this set EI, and you look at all quadruples, AB, A prime, B prime, such that AB is the distance from AB is equal to distance A prime to B prime, then the number of such quadruples is roughly the sum of the squares of the sizes of the EI. Every pair of pairs in the same EI gives you such a quadruple. And you just now apply the Cauchy-Schwarz to lower bound this by the quantity here. And this is roughly, here you are counting all pairs of points, so it is n squared, it's n to the 4, divided by x. So all you need to do is get an upper bound on the number of quadruples and actually show that it is n cubed log n. And if you combine the two things, you get that x is at least n over. But the number of such quadruples is exactly the number of pairs of those lines, h, a prime, et cetera, that pass through a common point, which you can rewrite by simply summing over all the points where at least two lines go through, and square the degree, the number of lines that pass through such a point. This is exactly what you need to count. And you can rewrite it by the sum of k square over all integers k at least 2 times the number of points or rotations that have degree exactly. Okay? And you can rearrange the sum to write it as sum k times the number of rotations of the degree at least k. And Elikash's conjecture was that this later quantity, the number of rotations that map at least k points of your input to k other points of your input, is at most m cubed over k squared, which if you think about it in terms of those lines, your n squared such lines, it's the number of lines to the 3/2 divided by k squared. The 3/2 is the same exponent as in the joints problem, and for a reason. And if given that you can show that, then you simply substitute this for this, and you get this harmonic series, you get n cubed log n, and you get the lower bound on the number of these indices. So it remains to prove Elikash's conjecture from which the claim on the number of distinct distance the problems are quite similar because both the joints and the distinct distances, because they talk about incidences between points and lines in three dimensions. And this algebraic machinery helps both of them. Both of them were quote unquote unsolvable before with the traditional methods, and now they are more or less handled successfully, the distinct distances still has this gap of square root log n, if you notice, but for now, we might consider this as more or less settled. Let me spend a couple of slides on the notion of incidences, although because this is a main topic in this review. The simplest example would be that you have a set of points and a set of lines. Say m points and n lines in the plane. That's the simplest instance probably. And you call IPL the number of incidences between P and L, which is the number of pairs a point in P lying on a line of L. In this example, you can count there are quite a few incidences in the field. So you want an upper bound for this quantity. The number of incidences should always be at most such and such. And this is the starting celebrated result of Semerady and Trotter from 1983 that show that the maximum such number is proportional to m to the 2/3, n to the 2/3 plus m plus n. You write plus m plus n in case m is too small relative to n or vice versa. But roughly it is m to the 2/3, n to the 2/3. The bound is tight. There are constructions where this is the number of incidences appear in all kinds of applications. Maybe the most surprising one is its relation to the Kakeya problem that Wolf in the 90s has noticed this connection, and that actually has drawn Gutenkatz, I think, to look at these incidence problems and distinct distances because it was related to the things they were mainly interested in, this Kakeya problem. And there are all kinds of other reasons why people are looking at it. Now, points and lines are a very special case. You can think of a large number of possible generalizations. For example, you can think about incidence between points and surfaces, points and other curves in the plane. You can go to higher dimensions and talk about incidence between points and lines in three dimensions, points and curves, points and planes, surfaces, even higher dimensions. The problem gets harder and harder, and surprisingly, the Semerady-Trotter bound is one of the very few, maybe there are a few more examples, but mostly this is the only tight known bound on the number of incidences. In all other cases, we can prove upper bounds, but the lower bounds are far away from it. Okay, now one important thing to keep in mind that if we talk about incidences between points and lines in three dimensions, which is both the joints and the distinct distance problem talk about, you have to be careful not to fall into the trap that essentially, if you have the bound in two dimensions, it applies in any dimension. Because a lower bound in two dimensions holds in three dimensions as well. And if you have points in line in three dimensions, you just project them on a random plane and generic plane and apply the planar. So you do not get anything interesting in three dimensions unless you make the problem, quote unquote, truly three dimensional. So you don't want to see too many of the points or too many of the lines in a common plane, because then you are down to the Semmeredith-Rotter planar bound, which you don't want. Okay. And so this is just a list of some of the algebraic techniques that have been introduced to solve these problems. Most important here is the polynomial partitioning technique, which I will mention in a minute. There are all kinds of other tools. Some go back to the 19th century, and I'll mention a couple of them, one of them at least soon. And let me just kind of talk in a little bit in more detail about how you do point line incidences in three dimensions. So actually, the bound on distinct distances and everything else, and Elikesh conjectures and so on, are actually consequences of this incidence theorem, which, again, you have points and lines in three dimensions, m points and n lines, and you make this assumption that no plane contains more than square root of n lines. You can change the square root of n by other parameters, but this was the original assumption of Gluck and Katz. And then you get this bound, which by inspecting these fractions, you see that it is better than two surfaces, unless m or n are too large. How do we prove it? We use this notion of polynomial partition, the main algebraic tool that was introduced by Gluck and Katz. And it says the following, that you have a set of n points in d dimensions, and you want to break them into t or order of t subsets so that each subset should contain roughly the same number of points. You can do it by constructing a polynomial, a d variate polynomial of degree d, which is of the order of t to the 1 over dimension, 1 over a little d. And the partition is affected by the connected components of the complement of the zero set of the polynomial. So that every connected component of the complement of the zero set contains more or less the same number of points, roughly n over d. The proof is based on the polynomial ham sandwich theorem of Stone and Tukey. It's actually it's actually not a very complicated proof once you accept the ham sandwich result. Okay, just an illustration. The blue is the zero set of the polynomial, and every connected component in this construction contains most 2 points. Notice that there might be some points that lie on the zero set, and the theorem says nothing about how many such points there are. It only guarantees that in each connected component of the complement there would be the right number of. The points that lie on the zero set is a problematic feature of this construction. Now, the first part here is just a restatement of what I said before, but instead of using this t, I tell you what degree I allow you. And it's the same result. In this case, you get the d to the d connected components, and each component contains n over d to the d. Later, good has extended this result to the case where you are not given points, but you are given higher dimensional varieties. For example, lines in three dimensions or whatever. Then partitioning is a misnomer because you do not partition, but you still partition space. You don't partition the lines or the varieties, but you can still do something very similar. So you have n, just think about it as n lines in three dimensions, for example, which is the case that we want. I give you a degree d, then you can decompose free space into d cube components so that each component is crossed by at most n over d square lines. So the same line will cross many components, but no component will be crossed by too many lines. So this is a harder, one needs more complicated machinery to show it, but is now part of the repertoire. I'm sorry? the polynomial that does the partitioning is not necessarily the
integer. No,
I'm sorry?
Integer
is yes. Yeah, we might as well assume that they are. Mm-hmm. Yes. They are irreducible. If, if they are reducible, just consider their irreducible components or something. Yes. But let's assume that they are irreducible.
But D is irreducible, right?
No, no. D is the degree of the polynomial. The degree of the variety does not show up here. I assume it is a small constant. The varieties are algebraic, irreducible algebraic varieties of dimension k and of some bounded degree which is hidden in the notation. Yeah, the degree of the variety is supposed to be something small and constant, and the constant of proportionality here depends on the degree of the variety. But I'm not showing it. So, you have to certainly you have to include it. But say if you think about lines, then this is what you get. Degree, yeah. You have to use things like Bezout theorem and things like that to estimate the degree is fixed. The degree is fixed and is hidden in this O big O notation. If they are reducible, but again, there will be only a constant number of them. So yes, yeah. All right. Okay, this is some commercial. Why is this so important to have polynomial partitioning? And it is important. It has been used in scores of papers, if not more, since in the past 10 years. Let me show you very quickly how you get the incidence bound of Gutenkatz. So this slide is misleading because this is the easy part. So I have m points and n lines in three dimensions, and I partition three space by a polynomial of degree d, and I can do it in such a way that both theorems of Gutenkatz and of Gut holds. So I can get d cube cells, so each contains roughly m over d cube points and is crossed by roughly n over d square lines. And now I need a trivial bound on how many incidents can there be between m points and n lines, and apply this trivial bound in each cell. And the trivial bound is the number of points square plus the number of lines. And you show it simply by here is a point, here is a line that passed through it. If that line has an extra point, charge the incidence to this pair of points. And no pair of points will be charged more than once or twice, because for every pair of points, there is only one line. So you'll get this number of points squared. But if the line has no other points to charge, charge the incidence to the line, and you'll get plus n. So this is an easy bound. And if you just substitute this bound for within each cell and multiply by the number of cells, you get this quantity, and you just balance these two expressions by choosing d to be this number. Again, assuming that m is not too small and not too large, otherwise you have to do something else. And then if you substitute it here, you'll get this. But the weakness or the cheating in this slide is that I ignored points that lie on the zero set. And I have no control. I have no idea how many such points there will be. And I need to do something special to handle. So what comes out of it is that I have this variety, the zero set of the polynomial of degree d, and I have points on it, and I have lines. Lines that are not fully contained in the variety are easy because they intersect the variety in only a small number of points, d points, and that's easy to handle. So I have a variety of degree d, I have m points, no idea how many points, and lines that are fully contained in the variety, how many incidents can I get? So it all boils down to the question, can a surface of degree d, an algebraic surface, contain many lines? And the answer is yes and no. So it can contain many lines, but only if it is ruled by lines. So it is the generated by a family of lines. It is the union of all these lines. There are two examples, the only two examples of surfaces that are ruled by, doubly ruled by two such families. One is the hyperboloid of one sheet, given by an example like this, for example, and one is the hyperbolic paraboloid. But the 19th century result of Cayley and Salmon, which is also attributed to Monge, says that if the surface is not ruled by lines, it can and it is of degree D, it can contain at most D times 11D minus 24 lines, which is quite an interesting and useful result. So now you simply go, actually you go through every irreducible component of the zero set. If it is not ruled, it does not contain too many lines, and you handle it somehow, maybe by induction or by some other argument. If it is singly ruled, you are still fine, because in principle, every point on the surface is incident to just one generator line. And points that are incident to more than one generator line are singular, and they lie on a curve, and you can handle that too. And the doubly ruled surfaces are trivial to handle. And if there are irreducible components that are planar, then there is nothing that you can do, because now you have to use the Semmer-Editor result. And what saves you is that there are not too many lines on such a plane by assumption. And therefore, with some algebra, you see that what remains is this one. Okay, this is what we got from the cells. And everything else comes by handling the lines on surfaces in 3D. Okay, another commercial slide. just to say that by now we have solved, and believe we can solve, a large number of problems that only 10 years ago looked like hopeless. Problems that, you know, not in our lifetime problems. And now they are, quote unquote, trivially handled. Not very trivially, but still they are handled. Like these two examples that I mentioned. So I have still 15 minutes. So there are two more recent examples that I want to talk about. Let's see how much I'll certainly be able to handle one of them, maybe two if I will. Okay, so I want to mention next the following problem, which is a variant of the distinct distance problem. Now, you are in the plane, you have two lines, L1, L2, which I assume that they are not parallel and not orthogonal, not perpendicular. And there are n points on each of them, P1 set of n points on one of them, P2 on the other. And now I look only at the distinct distances between the lines, between points on one line and points on the other. Call it D, P1, P2. And then the result is that the number of such distinct distances is at least n to the fourth. Okay, so here are the two lines, here are the points. The observation is that if the lines are parallel or orthogonal, I can construct points on point sets on them that will realize only a linear number of distinct distances between them. If they are parallel, I just take the points equally spaced on both of them. If they are orthogonal, I take points at distances 1, root 2, root n from the intersection point. And Pythagoras tells us that I can get only a linear number of possibilities. So the theorem says if they are not parallel or orthogonal, then I get much more, n to the fourth. The best previous bound was n to the 5/4 by Elekesh. But now it's somewhat better. The original paper where we proved it reduced it to, the proof was not difficult, and it reduced it to an incidence problem between points and hyperbolas in the plane. But what I want to talk about here is that it is to view it as a special case of a more general theory that has been developed by Elekesh, of course, and Ronay, and Elekesh and Szabo in two respective papers, which we later slightly simplified the proof and improved the bounds. And the setup is as following. We have three sets of real numbers. The theory actually extends to the complex too, but let me talk about the real. Three sets each of n real numbers, and we have a trivariate polynomial of subconstant degree f, and we ask how many points of the Cartesian product a times b and c can be zeros of f. On how many points of this grid can f vanish? And for to make life a bit simpler, let me talk only about the what I call the bivariate case, where the polynomial is just z equal fxy, if you will. So it's z minus fxy. So it's like the graph of the bivariate function is three dimensions. The zero set. Okay, so so clearly the number of zeros is at most n squared, because if I fix a and b, there is at most one c, where that c is equal to f a b. And you can actually get quadratically many zeros from these two constructions. You can take the sets to be 1 through n, and the polynomial just the sum, or powers of some number to something, and the polynomial is the product. And in in both cases, you'll get quadratically many zeros. But the result of Elekesh and Ronay says that these are essentially the only two possible cases. So if you if you can really get quadratically many zero, it is because your polynomial has a very special form. It's not just x plus y or xy, because you can change coordinates. What the theorem says, what the theorem says is that if this is the case, if you have this polynomial and a times b times c, if the polynomial does vanish on quadratically many points of this Cartesian product, then it must be x plus y or x times y, or more generally, as shown here, it must be of the form a polynomial of q of x plus r of y or of q of x times r of y. And it's also interesting that p, q, and r must be polynomials. But if it does not have this, this special form or forms, one of these special forms, then the number of zeros can be at most n to the 11th. So it's either quadratic, special form, non-special form, n to the 11th. And the distinct distance along two lines is just a special case of this case, because the polynomial is just the square distance, which is this by the law of cosine. Theta is the angle between the lines. And A is the set, the x coordinate, or whatever, the distance from the intersection point of one set of points, and b is p2, the other set, and c is the set of all squared distinct distances between p0 and p2. So the sets here are not equal. This is n points, and here we don't know how many, but there is a variant of the theorem that also works for unequal sets, and this is what I'm going to use in a minute. So how many zeros does the polynomial have on a times b plus c? So trivially it has n squared zeros, because every point in p1 and every point p2 gives a value which is included in c. So we know that the bound is n squared. Now, does this polynomial have the special form? So the surprising thing is that it does not when the angle is not 0 or pi over 2, when they are not parallel or orthogonal. But if they are, then it does have. For example, if theta is pi over 2, we have x squared plus y squared, which is like x plus y, is the form of general. And also when theta is 0. So here the sets do not have the same size, but the general bound that we got, the 11.6, come from those parameters. It is p1 to the 2 third, p2 to the 2 third, c to the 1 half. There are some other terms, but this is the important one here. And 2/3 plus 2/3 plus 1/2 is 11/6. That's what you get when they are all equal. But here they are not equal. And so you get n to the 4/3 c to the 1/2 is an upper bound, but you know that the number is exactly n squared. You solve for c and you get that it is at least n. So it is a special case of this general result about polynomials vanishing on grids. There is much more to say about it, and there is little time. So I'll just say that much about this problem. And the last set, or the last problem I want to talk about, let's see how much I can tell you about it, has to do with eliminating depth cycles among lines in three dimensions. These are several related works. I'll concentrate on the first one in a longer universe. I would try to mention some of the other results too, but not now. So what am I talking? What is the problem I'm talking about? Again, we have set L of n lines in three dimensions, general position. They are, do not touch each other. They are not vertical. They are not parallel. Nothing bad happens. And we can define their depth relative to the point at infinity, at z equal infinity, say, by just saying which line passes above which other. So here is L1 and L2, and L2 passes above L1 because the vertical line, the unique vertical line that passes through both of them, passes through L1 below where it meets L2. So L1 is smaller than L2 in this relation, depth relation. So this is a total relation in our setup, but it can have cycles. Like in this, every line lies above the next line in the cycle. And you want to eliminate all cycles. By that I mean that you want to break the lines into segments and rays, cut them with a scissor into pieces, so that the pieces will have an acyclic depth relation. Will have a depth. It will not be a total relation anymore, but it will be S. So here, for example, if I cut any of them, if I cut the blue line here, or the red line here, or the yellow line here, I eliminate this. So this is a problem that is about 35 years old, and before these algebraic developments, there were practically nothing known about it. Very few special cases, very miserable upper bounds. Of course, you can always get an n square bound by cutting every line near the point where it goes over another line. So if I cut these two lines here and the two lines here and two lines here, I eliminate all cycles trivially, but I want a subproblem. And there is some motivation from computer graphics that comes from the so-called Painter's algorithm, where instead of lines, you have triangles, this joint, and you want to draw them properly on the screen so that you don't see hidden parts of them. And the idea is to draw them back to front. You draw the farthest triangle first, then you draw the next one, erasing the parts of the first triangle that it hides, and keep doing it until you get the correct picture. But you can do it only if there are no cycles, otherwise there is no way. So breaking cycles has some application from that point of view, and lines is like a special case. There is even a more special case, which is the famous joints problem. Because if I take the joints, if I take a situation where the lines have joints, where they are not degenerate, and I slightly perturb, just shift the line slightly, then if I do it right, the joint will turn into a very tiny triangular cycle, like here. So if, since I know that I can have n to the 3/2 joints, I will get n to the 3/2 such tiny triangular cycles, which I will need to cut each separately. Cutting one of them will not help me eliminate any other cycle. So I need at least n to the 3/2 cuts. And what we showed is that we can actually almost do that. We can cut the lines into n to the 3/2 some polylogarithmic, additional polylogarithmic factor cuts so as to eliminate all the depth. And the proof uses polynomial partitioning, in a somewhat unorthodox way because there are no incidences. But it still works. But looking at the watch, and it's kind of cute to see how it works, but probably in another incarnation. Probably I should just stop here and just to show you that there are slides. So there are many open problems. The area is more than 10 years old, but there is still a lot of mysteries. Perhaps the hardest problem that is still unsolved, not hardest, but the next difficult problem that is still unsolved is to get a bound on a number of distinct distances in three dimensions. There, the conjecture is that it is at least n to the 2/3 down from near linear, because a grid will give you such an upper bound. But if you try to follow Elikesh ideas, you get incidence problems between 2 or 3 dimensional creatures in 7 dimensions. With some effort, you can get down to 5. But it's still much harder than we know how to handle now. But there is hope. Okay, and I'll stop here. And again, very happy birthday to Natali. Thank you. Feeling is that there is much more this method can do. Yes. Thank you.